Hi, it's Kate, and this is the second video for week 5 of Math 23. Let's continue our discussion of the rational and real numbers. Well, first of all, the rational numbers and the real numbers each form an ordered field, which means that there is a relation, which looks something like this, right? Less than or equal to, with the following properties. If you have two elements of this field, either A is less than or equal to B, or B is less than or equal to A. If A is less than or equal to B and B is less than or equal to A, then A equals B. Definitely often exploit that type of idea in proof strategies of proving equalities. If A is less than or equal to B and B is less than or equal to C, then A is less than or equal to C. That's a transitive property. And if A is less than or equal to B, then A plus C is less than or equal to B plus C. If A is less than or equal to B and 0 is less than or equal to C, then A times C is less than or equal to B times C. Many important properties of infinite sequences of real numbers can be proved on the basis of ordering, which basically gives us an idea of magnitude of the real numbers. So if we think of the rational numbers or the real numbers as lying on a number line, we can interpret the absolute value of the quantity A minus B as the distance between point A and point B, which can also be written as this. In two dimensions, the statement that the distance between A and B is less than or equal to the distance between A and C plus the distance between C and B means that the length of one side of a triangle can't exceed the sum of the lengths of the other two sides. And even the name triangle inequality still applies in the one-dimensional case when we're just talking about when C equals 0. And in that case, this statement right here, that the absolute value of the sum of A plus B is less than or equal to the sum of the absolute values, is slightly different than this, but this is also referred to as the triangle inequality. So there are many well-known rules of algebra that are not included on the list of field axioms. As you guys know, they are provable using the list that we've been given. That's all the way back to week 1. And however, there are properties of the real numbers that cannot be proven from the field axioms alone because they rely on the axiom that the real numbers are complete. And what we mean by complete is that there are no holes along the real number line where real numbers do not exist. The completeness axiom states a few things. One of them is that every non-empty subset of the reals that is bounded above has a least upper bound. And the least upper bound is written as sup s, right here. It's not necessarily a member of the subset for which it is a least upper bound. Here's an example. Take a look at this set. It's an infinite set, with its elements being 1/2, 2/3, 3/4, 4/5. It goes on and on forever. 5/6, 6/7, 7/8, 8/9, 9/10, so on and so forth. Its least upper bound? You're right, its least upper bound is of course 1, but is 1 a member of the set? Nope, it's not. And we'll go on proving a bunch of different properties of the real numbers using the completeness axiom and some of its logical deductions. I know you're probably pretty skeptical because the completeness axiom just saying that every non-empty subset of the reals is bounded above by a least upper bound seems pretty unremarkable, but we're going to go into many different properties that can be proved using this completeness axiom. One of them is the Archimedean property of the real numbers that states that for any two positive reals, A and B, there exists a positive integer n such that n times A is greater than B. That seems pretty unremarkable, but in fact it's a good difficult proof showing that no matter how small A is or how large B is, there's always going to be some positive integer that when we multiply A by it, it will be greater than B. We also know that the rational numbers are a dense subset of the reals. This is a lot of new language, so make sure as you're going through this that you really understand what this means. What this means is that if you have two real numbers, A and B, and A is less than B, there always exists a rational number that is greater than A but less than B that you can fit right in between them. No matter how close A and B are together, you can always find a rational that lives between them. Again, the proof relies on the completeness axiom. Another thing to think about is that it's not unreasonable to think of the real numbers as infinite decimals, though there are some complications. In this view, pi, which is not even algebraic, right, because it needs to be a solution to that equation that we wrote on the previous page where there are integers involved. But in this view, pi, which is not algebraic, is the least upper bound of the following set. So that's another example of a set where the least upper bound is not a member of the actual set. And you might be wondering whether, okay, the rationals, they were countable, they were countably infinite, but are the reals? Well, the real numbers form an uncountable set. There's no bijection between them and the natural numbers. There's no algorithm with which we can assign a serial number to each real number, and they can't be enumerated. Here's the first, here's the second, here's the third, here's the fourth, and so on and so forth. That's something that we will be proving in class as well.